This is Radio 3. It's time now for Between the Ears, which continues this week of celebrations of our 60th anniversary of the launch of the third programme. The radio producer, Alan Hall, has been associated with this station for a third of those 60 years, and he's devised the following feature from archive recordings. 3 1/3 is an innovative and sometimes irreverent take on the station's cultural mission, how it's seen itself and has been seen, as well as some of the issues that have provoked controversy over the years. It's framed by one of Radio 3's more famous pauses, when John Holmstrom had to fill the gap for half an hour during a prom when things didn't go quite according to plan. Tonight's Between the Ears, 3 1/3.
Well, now there's a fair amount of reorganisation and reshuffling to be done on the platform now for the Bartok Second Piano Concerto, which follows. The orchestra at the moment is in the process of filing out to let the removers move in.
We present... investigation for radio. A very great program. Indeed.
We are rehearsing the opening announcement.
The third program started.
To begin... at the beginning.
The piano, I must say, doesn't seem to have made much progress. It doesn't appear able to make quite the leap onto the platform we were expecting of a nice, skittish young piano.
3. It's a magic number.
BBC Radio 3 on 90-93 FM and on digital.
You're listening to Radio 3. It's 20-6. And time for drama on 3.
I hope this new programme will give constant pleasure.
This is the BBC third programme.
This is the BBC third programme.
Hello.
You've already heard or read how it's intended to cater for the serious, attentive listener of all classes.
We were to present the great repertoire of music, drama and literature.
How it will broadcast concerts, operas, plays and other works of art in full.
And to give every speaker time to fold his legs and have out his talk, in Johnson's phrase, so long as he could hold his listener's attention.
How? It will have no fixed points.
And above all, we were to experiment.
That it should have been decided on, in the heat of a most deadly and devastating war, will, we hope, be seen abroad as but one example of British imagination.
Glancing nervously at the piano between sentences. But so far it hasn't moved. What else can I possibly read you? Well, let me see what I've got in my spare drawer.
Turn up the wireless, Mrs. Moss. Yes, dear, it is chilly tonight. Let's turn the wireless up a bit. That's right.
This is the BBC third programme.
That's better.
Going up, first floor, talks, feature, the Soviet view, 12-tone system, reef lectures, hospitality room, Neville Coghill, Dr. Pefsner...
Oh, I like anything, really. I'm not fussy. But I don't like too much talking. I can't get on with what I'm doing if there's too much talking. Can't make out what they're talking about half the time.
Suppose you take as your subject the existent round square. It would look like an analytic proposition that the existent round square exists. But it doesn't exist.
No, it doesn't. Then surely you can't say it doesn't exist unless you have a conception of what existence is. As to the phrase, existent round square, I should say that it has no meaning at all.
I quite agree. Then I should say the same thing in another context in reference to a necessary being.
Well, we seem to have arrived at an impasse.
Up, second floor, London Baroque Ensemble, medieval poetry, Toynbee, Aramaic mosaics, minor Elizabethans, recreation room.
I was glad to be able to put to the Director General my experience and belief that there were really quite a few people, and only a few, who would ever care for the great world of creative artistic endeavour.
acquired the new meaning of highbrow.
The subject about which I should like to speak is the nature and function of the intelligentsia in a modern society.
Yes, but do you think he's got a third program mind?
When he said to me, and he did, that 250,000 people was really too small to justify the expense of the third programme, I said 250,000 people listening to Isaiah Berlin was an enormous number, and that itself was a justification for the thing.
They had to believe in the power of scientific enlightenment. They had to feel themselves to be surrounded by an outer darkness against which they were fighting and into which they were trying to inject some kind of light. They had to believe in human progress. And only if they believed in all these things...
As for those who dislike being talked at,
for the brothers,
who believe that a performance of a great work of art speaks for itself...
As they. To have the means of expressing themselves articulately in public. Thereby...
We said that our programme would not have notes, that we'd take the horse to water, but wouldn't try to make him drink.
Because those who stand on public platforms and speak are obliged to tell the truth, as those who do not are not.
I remember writing at the time that the third programme does not admit the necessity of...
Only those who believed in the mission, in other words, of the educated, in the mission of those who spoke in public, in the mission of those who were capable of influencing their fellows, only these were members of the intelligentsia.
I'm just being told that the electrics have got stuck and they've got to wind it up by hand.
I say, could we have the radio down a little, please?
Yes, let's have it down a little.
Well, I think that I gather this is going to take another 3 or 4 minutes, so it might almost be better to hand you back to continuity, because they can at least play you a little record or tell you about some forthcoming programme. So, provisionally, I think we'll hand you back to the studio.
Some have suggested I ought to listen to one of those spontaneous discussions. Spontaneous discussions, you know, not too provocative, but of course, not afraid either to say what they mean.
Aye, sir. Discussion's one thing, but culture's another. Discussion, anybody who's in trade unions and the labour movement knows about discussion. But culture isn't for us. And I said, well, that's terrible to my ears.
I don't think it was a manifestation of democratic movements at all. It was, on the contrary, rather undemocratic. There were those who wished it to be exactly that. I wanted to make these things available to these people if they wanted to listen to it.
The word culture wasn't in any sense an abstract or pretentious word. It was seemed to be part of the skin of the life we were encouraged to lead.
And here we are back in the Continuity Studio in Broadcasting House. Rather a pity, really. I was quite enjoying the talk about the piano and looking forward to its getting onto the platform somehow. However, until things look like improving, in the Albert Hall here is a little bit of music.
It's a magic number.
And the one thing that we've got to be careful of is your money.
Well, it's one for the money, two for the show.
I think there's any chance of the third programme broadcasting for longer hours. Wynn, can you help us on that?
The third programme hours at the moment now could be extended, but only at considerable cost.
Could we move on to patronage of the arts? Would anyone like to come in on that?
I wonder if before we go on to that, if I may...
You will have seen in your Radio Times the details of the new music programme which starts today. This is the gentle beginning which will gather strength until by next March the BBC will broadcast more than twice as much good music as now.
Up the rice in the church where a wedding has been. Lives in a dream.
Gentlemen, this new agreement makes it possible for the BBC to broadcast gramophone records for 75 hours a week. 75 hours of needle time, as it's called, instead of being restricted to 28 hours as at present. Now, this is a big extension, but why should there be any limitation at all on the broadcasting of gramophone records? Mr. Ratcliffe, what's the musician doing? Faced with this prospect of a constant outpouring of music, there will be some who are perhaps torn between delight that being able to hear fine works at almost any moment of the day, and on the other hand, a fear that if music is to become a perpetual companion, if we are to live in an auditory decor, as it were, then somehow our delight in it may grow less, and music itself will be cheapened.
That's always been fundamental, that Radio 3 is not an oral wallpaper channel.
I share this fear just a little myself.
If the BBC simply used gramophone records instead of employing any musicians, it wouldn't be very long, would it, before the music profession ceased to exist?
It's a controversial matter.
Charles Cowan on the patronage of music.
Well, I didn't want, in fact, to go on at this stage to the patronage of music, because I'm sure that's going to come up as a quite separate issue.
The general repertory of this new programme is intended to satisfy those who are able to give it their full attention, without driving away others who, for one reason or another, will treat it as an accompaniment.
To look at radio from the point of view of what the listener or viewer gets from it would be to overlook a vital part played by the BBC, that of an enlightened patron of the arts.
Is it really right, I wonder, in the last analysis, Mr. Arkell, for the BBC to act as a private patron of music in this sort of way?
I don't think it's a private patron. The BBC is a public corporation. I think here it has a duty, publicly, to foster the arts.
But surely our job is actually to broadcast. Our job is to entertain listeners. It isn't necessarily to patronise the arts or encourage anything like that particularly.
Well, I think in that case you're working for the wrong institution, if you believe that, because I think that the function of a BBC which expects a licence fee, there must be something which we put back into the country in return for that, and I regard that as patronising the arts, developing the culture, nurturing the musical profession.
The BBC has long been recognised as the most powerful single influence in British musical life.
The BBC, all through my lifetime, and I am now middle-aged, has been the greatest educated force of the 20th century.
The basic question is, what ought we to be doing? And if we ought to be doing something of quality and high standards, it is going to cost a great deal more money than a basic lowest rung service of one record after another. And we're about the business of developing the musical culture in this country.
The BBC should not act as a patron, but as a pacemaker, as a creator.
If we are not creators, we are nothing.
I'm awfully sorry you're having to wait so long for this piano concerto by Bartok. But the reason for the delay is that the removal men in the Royal Albert Hall are having a little bit of bother getting the piano onto the platform.
I have always believed that every civilized nation, culturally and educationally, is a pyramid with a lamentably broad base and a lamentably narrow tip. Very unfortunately, the measure of success was always the listening figures.
We are financed by public money, and there is therefore a need to consider a minimum audience, something between 50 and 100,000, and it could be enlarged given the lively style of broadcasting.
Because the Third has this rather forbidding image which has grown up over the years, it doesn't get the audiences it ought to.
Then we expected a lot from our listeners. We expected them to meet the performers halfway by giving them their whole attention.
The rather more esoteric, in other words, that element which can rather rudely be described as dons talking to dons.
But, I mean, if you eventually go down the road of pleasing people, of thinking your only job is to please people and to give them what they want, then you're absolutely on the slippery slope of lowest common denominator. And on all this, what disgusts me now is this use of the word accessibility and all the rest of it to suggest that you will eventually produce broadcasts which is so bland that nobody could possibly object to any side of it.
It's a magic number.
This is BBC Radio 3, 90 to 93
it's
FM.
It's 10 o'clock. This is
BBC Radio 3.
On Radio 3, the separate labels of music programme and third programme would disappear. And the daytime stream of music would be extended more into the evening. But the network would keep some of its other cultural programmes.
On the whole, the loss of the name did not necessarily imply or mean the loss of the sense of mission. I think what we lost was an image.
At any rate, the phrase itself, third programme, has passed into the language with a meaning which, whether they like it or not, millions can understand.
Three, 90 to 93 FM and on digital
radio. This is BBC Radio 3 and the
BBC time. Radio 3, it's 7:30.
You're tuned to BBC Radio 3 FM.
Now, I think I've got to deal with one of these very painful matters. I've been putting it off, but I can't put it off any longer. It's this, really. If your television licence is due for renewal, or if you happen to know anyone who might have overlooked the renewal of a licence, sure they wouldn't have meant to, but they might have done so. I'm sure you won't mind my mentioning that the Home Office is currently carrying out a check on the locations of television sets from a fleet of detector vans. A fleet of them. They have a note of the addresses of every house and flat which doesn't have a license, and they can pick up a signal from a television set at a distance of 50 yards. Doesn't bear thinking of. Now, the owner could face a summons and a fine of up to £200 and ostracism in the local supermarket and the deepest shame when walking the dog. Things like that. Horrible. Now, at present, detector vans are circulating in the Greater London area and in the south of England generally, so please, please, for heaven's sake, make sure your television licence is in force. That's all I've got to say.
Here is Hugo Turvey to introduce tonight's performance by the Schola Polifonica Nisdaniensis.
But just turn the pages over every time I shout out, now, will you?
Certainly.
Now?
So let me tell you about a couple of programmes on Radio 3 tomorrow.
Now?
Well, I've come to the conclusion that modern so-called swing jazz is the folk music of today. That shocks you, doesn't it? You see, I hold the view that Ginger Rogers is the voice of the people, the song voice. And in years to come, long after you've gone, that's going to be the folk music of this present era. You know this one, don't you? Heaven, I'm in heaven. And my heart beats so that I can hardly speak. Boom, 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 boom. And then, of course, I say tomatoes, you say tomatoes, I say tomatoes.
We are sorry to have to mention it so early, but the still admirable third programme has in recent times been rudely truncated. We shall return to this point later.
For some people, a symphony orchestra may be more entertaining than a dance band. Most of us are capable of being entertained by both, but would be very sorry if we were only allowed to hear the band. The assumption behind the attitude of the BBC is alarming, because when generally unquestioned and accepted, such an assumption tends to demoralize democracy, discourage excellence, and enervate the nation.
Well, we've now heard from the Royal Albert Hall that things are looking up. The piano has got itself onto the platform. So to fill us in on the tale of this stubborn instrument, back now to the Royal Albert Hall and to John Holmstrom.
Well, I can't report total success, but I can report that progress has been made.
A taxi? Yes, sir. Sir? Where is it to be? Covent Garden Opera House, please. Oh,
all right. Going tonight?
Yes. Carmen tonight. You don't want to see that hackneyed old thing there.
Well, our wives...
Women have to be educated. I don't tolerate no nonsense in the home. No, I don't. My kids get no supper till they studied their Bartok on the upright. The wife don't get her housekeeping money till she's learned her Dylan Thomas by heart. Care to hear a little W.H. Auden while I drive?
It's a great privilege for me to be allowed to participate.
Under the platform, a team of gallant men, on their knees, have been winching the piano up by hand. There have been audible squeaks from the machinery rather than the men, though I dare say they've uttered a few groans as well. This hand winching, I gather, hasn't been done since about 1928 or something.
Experiment never stopped.
A colleague of mine, Miss Susan Bradshaw, and I myself went into a studio and we bashed about on percussion instruments for about 12 minutes. We also had a special mic in a corner screened off and put through an echo chamber where we produced the electronic noises like and so on. The purpose of it all, and here I'm getting serious, was not a hoax. It was really an experiment. Or if you like, I wanted to pose a problem. How far would this kind of thing be taken seriously?
Perhaps we went too far.
This isn't the way to Covent Garden. I'm not taking you there. But James, we've booked you tickets at the Arts Educational Establishment in Islington. Michael Tippett's lecturing there tonight, and there's a little concrete music in the interval. Fogel's quadripartita in five parts for two soda siphons and Chinese thumbscrews. A little conservative, but quite interesting.
BBC Radio 3. There's a Tom Crow in London. It's 7 a.m. Awful, isn't it? The news.
I mean, to giggle on the air would be absolutely unheard of. I mean, even to fluff.
Of course, we made mistakes.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. We were enjoying the Simple Symphony enormously, and suddenly the CD decided to halt, and we're actually here busy...
Turned up the knob in front without looking, alas, and I couldn't hear a thing. And panic seized me, and I pushed down the little talkback button that enabled me to talk to the engineer next door through a glass panel. And I said, I don't know what the hell's gone wrong here. What, of course, I'd done was to turn up the microphone instead of the gramophone.
So earlier on today, I phoned the chairman of the council at St. John's, Sir Duncan Oppenheimer, to see whether he was happy with a compromise which has just been reached.
It, I think, meets the...
I didn't say what the compromise was. Fuck!
And, of course, in those days, a third programme announcer just didn't say, hell...
A little slow hand clap is beginning. Not too surprising.
Shh. Hello there, folks. Hello, hello. Thank you, thank you. This is Mac McGurchin wishing you lots of fun. Now, who's first tonight, eh? A charming young lady in a most becoming hat, if I may say so. Oh, my, oh, my. And what is your name, young lady? Hmm?
Jean Gledding.
Jean Gledding. I dream of Jeannie with the nut brown hair. Oh, my.
It's not only broadcasting that has changed. People have changed. Society has changed. The world has changed.
The number of people buying records, the number of people going to concerts, going to opera, taking an interest in all those sort of things, has leapt up. And Radio 3 has perhaps been too slow to latch on to that.
Information, education, entertainment, these requirements in the BBC's charter remain.
It must be up for some kind of record for a pause in a prom concert on a Tuesday night, possibly any night, I'm not sure.
And these letters, purportedly from the most civilised and educated part of the society, were of such... very often such idiocy, such selfishness, such bias, such bigotry.
Without the listeners, you don't have anything.
These people have got tertiary education, they're people in responsible jobs. Why are they so thick? Why can they not understand that their taste is not the only norm by which you establish how something works?
Yo, I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want. Don't tell me what you want, what you really, really want. I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want. Don't tell me what you want, what you really, really want. I wanna really, really, really wanna zig a zig.
And what did you do in the war,
Jean? I was in the ATS.
The BBC's mission to enhance awareness of the richness of life, to support moral leadership in the nation, to raise public taste, also remains. The corporation would be otiose and sterile without it. That mission has to be accomplished by ever-evolving methods. It is the will that must stay constant.
Now, Jean Glidding of Bexleyheath has drawn number 69. Now then, who has number 69? 69, you, sir, are a gallant member of His Majesty's forces.
When will our moralists give us a clear answer to this question?
The human spirit needs something larger to cling to. Something with spiritual depth. Something timeless and sacred. This is provided by fine art, put another way, superlative art. And BBC's Radio 3 has enlightened the British public for half a century, helping us to develop and broaden our vision, giving us the strength to stand up against the materialist cynicism which tends to dominate the world at this moment in time. We must shun mediocrity and strive for superlatives.
Steve, rather belatedly, well, the lid has come up, that's something. The lid came up a great deal more rapidly than the rest of the piano.
No doubt. Right.
Here he is, Peter Donohoe, looking very cool, David Atherton, looking reasonably cool, and they're going to perform Bartok's second piano concerto, I promise.
Perhaps the British aversion to the unfamiliar in the arts has been just a little bit diminished.
We apologise to listeners for the technical hitches in the performance.
And it remains to me to thank the audience and to say good night to you all.
Three and the third.
This was the cast.
Isaiah Berlin, Bertrand Russell, Father Copperstone, Augustus John, T.S.L., W.H. Jordan, Hans Keller, John Bellamy, John Holmstrom, Tony Scott, Patricia Hugh, Pat Butler, Tom Crowe, Richard Fade, Natalie Weed, Petra Trelawney, Jeffrey Smith, Piers Bergen Page, Sarah Wolf, Sandy Burnett, Jill Anderson, Stephen Potter, Joyce Grenfell, Peter Houston, Mary O'Farrell, Harold Pinter, Alan Buller, Richard Burton, William Haynes, George Barnes, William Block, Stephen Hurd, John Drum, Nicholas Kahn, Gerard Mann, Frank Gillard, Armand Grant, Charles Carr, Alistair Bennett, Alan Poole, Brian Robertson, Anthony Howe, with music by Bert Kristen, Beatles, Roulette Bar, Britain, Ella Fitzgerald, Elvis, Eurythmus, Walter, Dizzy Gillespie, Marvin, Jack Johnson, Jimmy Henry, Monty Verde, The Mr. De Bois, David Munro, Oasis, Tuba, Sex Pistols, Spice Girls, Donald Swan.
Real two of two.
Brilliant stuff.
This was first broadcast in the third programme in October 1946.
I'm not a third programme fan.
Turned out quite all right.
Undoubtedly, the programme broke new ground in broadcasting. It's a magic number.
It is without any shadow of a doubt the greatest broadcasting channel in the world.
Amen.
Afraid I don't like radio very much.
Three and the Third was produced by Alan Hall. It was a Falling Tree production for BBC Radio 3.